Good morning, Ms. Roll. Okay, Ms. Roll, can you hear me?
Yes, I got you loud and clear.
Okay, great. I'm just going to walk over to the class that's going to be joining us. Do you want to play? And you can check, make sure you can play it. Larry, would you be able to be joined? Because Ms. Roll want to do a test run to make sure she can play it. I want to take this stuff over to the class. I have to warm them up and stuff. You want to do the test run?
I can do it quick.
Okay, you could do. You could just give us 2 minutes, Larry. You'll just come on and make sure.
No problem.
Hold the link. You want it, so let me know if you don't get it. I don't want this stuff.
Good morning.
Morning. Hey.
Hi. How are you?
I'm fine.
Wonderful.
Okay, so I could just do a dry. I could just make sure I play it again.
Okay.
Okay. The screen is black, right?
Yes.
Okay. You should be hearing something soon. You see anything?
I could see something, yes, but I don't hear anything as yet.
No, you're not gonna hear it right yet.
Okay, okay.
You hear anything in the background?
Yeah, a little something, but I can't really hear exactly what it's saying.
It's like a mumbling that's going to come loud.
Okay, okay.
Okay, so you hear it so far, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, and you can see the picture and everything.
Picture, yes.
All right.
Volume sound good.
Okay, it's working then. All right. Thank you.
No problem. Hi, Miss Rowe. Are you saying anything before? Are you saying anything before or after the film? Do you want to say anything before or after?
I'll introduce the film, but I think Ms. Mm-hmm. Charmaine Goodman-Davis, she's another volunteer. She's mm-hmm. supposed to be coming on to, I guess, to lead the questions and the answers.
Okay, so I'll be after.
Yeah.
Okay, not a problem.
Okay.
Okay, so the students will be joining shortly, okay?
Okay, then.
All righty. Miss Roll, you said Charlene Davis Goodman or Charlene Goodman Davis?
Charmaine Goodman Davis.
Charmaine. Okay, no problem.
Okay.
Good morning, everyone. I trust you all are having a wonderful morning and happy Valentine to all the lovers out there, lovers and non-lovers. Happy Valentine. I hope you all can hear me. We are having this martini with the Crisis Centre, but before we start the film, we're going to have Mr. Miller. He is going to open us in a word of prayer. And after the prayer, we're going to have Miss Radisha Rule. She's going to introduce the short film to you all.
Morning. Let us pray. Dear God and loving Father, we give thanks and honor and glory to you for this wonderful day. Truly, this is indeed the day that the Lord has made. And so we will rejoice and be glad in it. The psalmist declared that we ought to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. All ye lands, serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with thanksgiving. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. We are thankful for the gift of life. Many didn't make it to see this far, but we are once again grateful. Even as David declared that one thing have I desire of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold his beauty and to inquire in his temple. And so in this day, Father God, being double day of Valentine, a day of love, Father God, we want to be mindful that the greatest love is found in Christ Jesus. Your word says that you so loved us that you gave yourself, Father God, for us. You gave without looking for anything in return. And so, Father, we bless your name. We bless you, Father God, even as we reminded, Father God, that you see us, Father God, as peculiar in your sight. You see us as the apple of your eyes. And so that is the greatest love of all. Even when men see something else different in us, you see in us greatness. And so we are thankful. Now, Father God, we remind our participants, Father God, that conversation is the seed of relationship. And so, Father God, as we conversate, Father God, we open access, Father God, and access is the proof of opportunity. And so we will open some opportunities. And so we also remind our participants, Father God, that the proof of love is the investment of time. And so, Father God, your word declared that you will never leave us. You will all never forsake us. You always invest time to be with us, Father God, to get to us, Father God, that we might know the good things you have in store for us. Be glorified for the rest of this service, for the rest of this service, Lord. You be glorified, you be magnified, you be exalted. And whatever we do, let it be done for your honor and glory. May the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, rule in our heart, mind, soul, and spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, all. My name is Radisha Rule. I work at the Crisis Centre. This morning, we are going to show you a short Bahamian film, all Bahamian actors, Bahamian producers, that we created in 2017, just to have something that's more our way, to show you different red flags and signs of domestic violence, how family violence affects persons in a circle, and how everything is in rotation and it comes back to you. So just enjoy the film. It's about 16 minutes, and then Ms. Charmaine Goodman Davis will come on and answer any questions and questions you may have after the film. Thank you.
Woman. I'm still coming back from that flu. The doctor said I got a rest.
And what about me? What I need? I look dead to you.
Tyrone, come on, man, leave me alone.
You don't know your Bible, eh? You're my wife.
Tyrone,
you got a goddamn boundary. Shut up, you.
Tyrone, stop! You hurting me, Tyrone. Tyrone, stop!
Shut up.
Close your eyes and may your days be long. May you rise on the morning when his kingdom come. Good deeds aren't remembered in the hearts of men. Bless your eyes and may your dreams come true. May you rise on the morning when your kingdom come. Good deeds aren't remembered in the hearts of men.
Kareem, give me this ball, man.
That's my ball, Dario.
It's a cease, don't play ball.
My aunt gave that to me. Give it back.
I give it back when I'm ready.
Good afternoon.
You okay, Steven?
That's hungry. What y'all doing?
I'm about to take my favorite niece downtown.
Can I go?
Not today, young man. Trinae and I have some catching up to do. Need to find out about this fella. Make sure she ain't getting herself in no trouble. How's school?
Fine.
Your aunt tells me you've been coming first in history.
Yeah.
Is that what you want to do?
I ain't know yet.
But you won't go to college, right?
Of course I do, but I don't think Auntie Candace has the money.
But I could help with that. By that time, I should have some good contracts lined up.
Hi, can I help you?
I like this top.
You don't think that too bare?
But that's what's wearing.
Yeah, but that don't mean that you gotta look like all the rest of them girls.
How much is the top?
$15.
You sure that's the one? All right.
Nice.
Where's Stephen?
Where's he going now?
You know I won't see you in that pretty talk. Where you going? You know better than to hide from me, Trinae. What happened? You don't like your uncle no more?
Good afternoon, young man.
Hey, how you doing? You live around here?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, we're from the Crisis Center, and we're doing a walkabout in the community just to get a better understanding of the area. And we're wondering if we could ask you a few questions. I promise it ain't gonna take long.
Yes, ma'am.
Is there someone you know who you think might want to talk to us? You know, there's nothing to feel bad about. Here, take one of these flies.
Thanks. Girl, I need your good taste.
You know I ain't into Maxwell.
Trinae, you ain't into anyone?
I just don't like thugs, and he's the biggest one I know.
Help me match my new skirt.
It's cute.
You like it?
I don't understand why you need to go looking for trouble.
Come here. I'm gonna take a seat with you. I thought you wasn't gonna ever make it, man. So, I need you smoke?
Sometimes.
You know, like if you have a little smoke.
I'm ready for you going for another Guinness. Want anything?
No, he said, but let me get one pack of beauty, though. Give me one pack of beauty.
Bring it ready for
it. Yeah, I respect. So, you look nice.
Thank you.
Alright, you're welcome.
You just got home?
Yeah.
You hungry?
No, not really.
Well, I baked some pork chops. It's in the fridge.
I'm good.
What's this?
A woman gave this to me.
Well, why are you showing it to me?
I wasn't. I was just checking if you were home.
Thank you. the boss have a way that answers my phone. My daddy's in the hospital. I don't think this is a good idea. Stop!
I'm stopping nothing, boy.
Stop!
Show me stop.
Get off.
What? Lay down, stop making noise. Relax.
Hey, what's going on now?
Try to get a piece of this yourself, boy.
Are you on your own? Stop!
Get off.
Look here. Shh, making so much noise, boy. Ghost is getting killed.
Hello, Bahamas Crisis Centre. Hello, Bahamas Crisis.
Shut up, yo. I know you like that.
Bro,
hold on,
bro. You're gonna have to go back behind the line like everyone else, okay?
King, this is my house. This is my house, King. Why are you gonna stay around my house, boss?
Hold on, what's your name?
My name is Maxwell Colby, sir.
You're the son of Michelle Colby?
Yes, that's my mother.
Okay, look, there's been an incident, okay? Your father and mother got in an altercation. She's in critical condition right now. We're looking on her, but... No, I'm sorry.
Mommy!
You're
gonna
have to
stay calm.
You're gonna have to stay calm, sir. Alright? Just.
We tell me make him a knob of shit, yes, boy! Get off me, boy! Mommy! Boy, get him, baby, yes. Get him, boy!
You're gonna have to stay calm, okay? Alright?
I can stay calm!
Bahamas Crisis Center.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Okay. Everyone's quiet, so I'll now turn it over to Ms. Charmaine Goodman Davis. She's on.
Good morning. Can everybody hear
morning.
Me?
Good morning. Yes, we can.
Okay, morning, so morning. We are now going to open a discussion as it relates to what we all just viewed. You can ask questions, share your comments, or just share your thoughts. Any questions? Okay, let me ask a question to get us started. Can someone share just one situation that really got your attention, if only one? No one wants to share?
I'll share.
Okay.
Good morning. I'm Pamela McCartney, the counselor here at BTVI, as well as an adjunct instructor. And as a part of my job and from my past experiences working with abusers, most of the times, I guess the situation with the, I guess that was the wife, the mother, who was being abused by the by a partner, whether it was a husband or a boyfriend, I didn't know. But in listening to a lot of persons or hearing their stories, people don't like to talk about what's going on. They're very hesitant about sharing because they feel nothing is going to be done to better their situation or to get them out of that particular situation. What role does the crisis center have in getting persons to open up and sharing their story and helping them to solve the problems that they're encountering?
Okay, first and foremost, the crisis center has a 24-hour hotline. And for the purpose of this exercise, I'll ask Ms. Rule to place the number in the chat so that everyone can have access to it. As it relates to the hotline, there is always someone who is supposed to be at the end of the line to respond to calls. Now, of course, life happens. There are times when, for whatever reason, a volunteer may not be able to answer. However, there is an option to leave a message. I know if someone is in deep crisis, they don't want to speak to an answering machine, but life happens, and realistically, that's a possibility. So with 24-hour hotline, the individual or individuals can call and speak with the whoever is on the line working for that particular time. It's 24-hour man, so that he or she, because we're not only catering to females, we cater to females, males, and children who are old enough to use the phone, because in my experience, I have had minors call during stressful times. They feel the stress too. And so while we have to work with their parents to help them, if they call and it's a crisis, then we need to use our common sense as to what to do, whether we get information to find out where this child is and refer to the police, because we don't go to homes. We are on just the other side of the phone. And so as it relates to that first means of outreach, it's the hotline, the 24-hour hotline. Secondly, the crisis center provides counseling as well as legal advice, depending on your circumstances. If it needs to be referred, then it is. But we do have an open door policy where individuals can come in for short-term or long-term counseling, as well as just coming in to get advice, even legal advice, that is. And all of our services, let me put it out now, are free of charge. Okay, so that is what we're doing. And we partner with other entities to assist us where we may need assistance. But the core work of assisting individuals in crisis is done in-house. Does that answer your question fully?
Thank you, yes.
Any other questions at this time? If not, okay, I'm going to just try to engage you enough to want to participate in this exchange. There were a number of issues touched on in the movie, in the film rather. Did anyone, I'm on a cell phone, so I can't really scope who all is on the call, but please feel free to open your mic and share at any point. The very first scene touched on the spousal violence, right? And we saw where a mother, well, we will conclude or assume that she is or was being continually abused based on how resolved the mother-in-law, grandmother seemed to be. She had the look on her face as though, okay, this is happening again. This is not the first time, because usually people are more hyped up and more angry at an initial incident, but the mother-in-law seemed just resigned to, okay, here we go again. Then there was a young boy in that scene as well, who obviously had issues with what was happening to his mother, but what could he do as a child? So what did he do? He got angry, he bottled up his frustration, and the first opportunity he had to, I guess, flush his system is to do what? Bully. That is where you saw him go, and that was the boy who went onto the basketball court and harassed, bullied, and eventually stole the other young man's ball. And so that was his way of dealing with the frustration he felt because of what was happening in his home. So what happened after that? We saw where a young girl was taken out, we will say taken out, with an older man. Now, he referred to himself as her uncle. Could have been an uncle, so it could have been an incestuous situation, or it could have been an older man who, for providing the young lady with items, things that she would need or want for sexual favors. So therein lies a problem. If it's an uncle, it's incest. If it's just an old man with a younger girl, it's just something that should not happen because, well, obviously, she's a very young girl, you can see that. And he's an older man. And so that's, we know of instances like that. I'm sure all of us have either heard of it or heard someone make a remark about something like that. And if you haven't, then that's awesome. But it happens in our communities and it's not right. People seem to accept it for whatever reason. And it's like an eating sore, because if an older man is taking care of a young girl, what possibly could she be doing for him other than sexual favors? And that is not an ideal situation under any circumstances. So then we went on to another situation, I will call it, where we saw a young girl happy to be going on a quote unquote date. And what happened there? She was taken advantage of against her will. And there's something that I need to point out here in that particular portion of the script. We saw a young man come to the door, see what was going on, heard what she said about, no, she clearly stated she did not want what was happening to happen. He saw that, he heard her, and he turned around and he walked away. Bystanders are able to intervene. I know that it's risky depending on the circumstances, but we have a lot of people who are satisfied with being bystanders and just, okay, well, what can I do or what am I supposed to do? In a case like that, a young girl is being raped or at least sexually assaulted against her will, or having sex against her will. That in itself is a crime. And while we may not feel inclined to and get ourselves involved, it could mean the difference between saving someone's life or not. So we need to give consideration, of course, caring for self first, but we need to give consideration of situations we may be privy to or may happen to walk into where someone obviously has something done to them that they don't want done. So we need to be able to be our neighbor's keepers, particularly when children are involved, because children are more vulnerable than the average adult. And so let's be mindful of that. Any questions or comments at this point before I continue? Can everybody hear me?
Yes, the young man who came upon that situation, I think he dealt with it in a way that that he felt was appropriate for him, because like you say, I'm not getting involved in that. You deal with that, because you know that's your thing. But I understand that we ought to be our neighbor's keeper, right? But how far must that go? Because when you look at what's happening in our nation now, when I was a little boy growing up, there wasn't the proliferation of guns and all this young anger that was going around. He probably felt that if he had gotten involved in that, he would have been complicit in the act, and two, he may be putting himself in danger. So I wouldn't look too harshly at him. However, he had option to report the matter to the authorities that was happening. Now, if that fella was his friend, he would weigh friendship. He would weigh friendship to his friend, and he probably didn't know the girl. So he said, if my friend is doing that, that's on him. And so he just decided to disavow himself of the situation and move away.
Okay, thank you for sharing. Okay. Just one thing I'd like to add to that. If this guy really was his friend, I would imagine he could have at least made the effort to say, man, you know, don't go through this, you know, talk. I understand that in certain circumstances, friends or people who are supposed to be friends don't listen to good counsel, but he didn't even try. You know, he didn't even try. He just figured, okay, I'm disrupting something. But the fact that the young lady said, get off me or no, and he heard her, he should have at least said, what's happening here? What's going on here? You know, something, he could have said something. It may have made a difference. We don't know. For the purpose of this exercise, though, he did not do anything. He did not try to help. He did not try to dissuade his friend, if it was his friend or his roommate, from committing a crime, because obviously something was happening that the young lady did not want to happen. But I totally understand it's important to keep self safe. I get that. But I just felt as though he could have said something, and if he realized that the other guy had gotten hostile, then walk away. But say something. But I thank you for your input. Any other sharing or questions at this point?
Okay, Ms. Davis. My name is Ms. Cox in the Office of Student Affairs. And I know of a situation, I think I had mentioned it to Ms. Lowell, where it is alleged that someone reported and went to the police station, a minor, that she was being raped, right, in a home. Mm-hmm. But it was alleged that the police officer said they couldn't take a complaint because she was a minor to go back and bring your mom. Now, this is happening at home. Mm-hmm. If we go to if a minor goes to police officer to say that they're being molested or raped, right, what is the duty of that police officer? Is the duty for him to send her away and say, bring an adult with you? Was that correct what he did?
Okay, I will respond. I work in a police station, so I can respond to that.
Oh, great.
Okay, now it could get tricky, and here is why. The age of consent is 18. Well, they say 16 for sex, but you can't get a license until you're 18.
She was 12, sorry. She was 12 years old.
Okay, that's fine. But if a child, someone under the age of 16 walks into police station, unless there is visible trauma to that child, as in bleeding or something like that, it is important that the child has an adult. It doesn't have to be a parent. It could be an aunt. It could be someone from a church, but an adult needs to be there. Why? Simply because this person is a child. And if he or she is not accompanied, it could then leave the police open for a not good situation. It's never wise to have a child come into a station alone. There needs to be some type of adult support and accompaniment with a child. And so it is not ideal to send the child away,
right,
maybe the child could have been accompanied to the home or to a relative. There has to be somebody who can come with the child, who's prepared to serve as a support for the child before a statement can be taken from that child. Because the child doesn't really understand the process of what is happening. So an adult needs to be with that child.
So I thought social service should have been called. And why I'm saying that, because obviously the child feels like she can't trust the adult she's surrounded with, because she said that she lives home with her mom when they said to call an adult, and she said her mom knows. So the child said, well, my mom knows what's going on. And probably she feels there's no one that she can trust. So that, when is social service called? And shouldn't social service, shouldn't they have held the child and called social service in, and then social service perhaps visit the home along with the police officer? Wouldn't that have been
I can't speak specifically to that situation, but in my opinion, that is an option, to call someone from either social services, or depending on what the child was actually reporting, if she was like injured or something, it could have even called the ambulance to check the child, depending on what was going on. I can't speak to that specifically. However, any responsible and willing adult could stand with that child just to have someone who can support him or her to make a complaint. If the mother is the only relative that she's comfortable with, or I don't know the circumstances involving the case you're referring to, but someone from the church can even support that child, just a responsible adult who can stand with him or her and say, okay, this is what he or she is saying is happening or has happened. Social services would be, I think that would be an ideal support base, but again, we don't know the circumstances, the full circumstances of that case, because sometimes when you get a portion of a story, half of a story, or something else.
Okay, thank you.
All right, fair enough.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. It's a lot of legal aspects to it. So I get that. But I know if I was the officer, and I don't know, like you say, all of the sides of the story, but I know if I'm a police officer and a minor 12-year-old walks in and saying this is what's happened to me, I'm not going to if this is what happened indeed, I'm not going to say to the child, I don't know if this is happening, but I'm not going to say to the child, go and get an adult. I'm going to leave that child there. And then either I am going to call social service to make sure, because I don't want to call in an adult and that adult just sweeps it under the rug. So I am going to get social service involved and let social service do their part from there.
Right. Okay. Fair enough.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments at this point? Anybody? Everybody?
Why wouldn't the police officer accompany the girl to her home and see that? Isn't he tasked with protecting the citizens?
There again, I can't speak to that case because I don't know the circumstances.
No, we're talking about a hypothetical situation now. Wouldn't the police be minded to accompany the child and possibly see the validity of what she's talking about, searching for an adult to accompany her so she can make a statement?
Just on a straight up answer to you, it depends too on how many people are at the station. If there are only two people, okay. And there are instances where there are only two people in the station, he cannot abandon his post, he or she.
Okay.
So we have to look at that first and foremost.
Okay, ma'am.
And then I'm thinking, if it's a female child coming into the station, I don't feel that a male adult, even though he's a police officer, should be the only one in the car with the child. Depending on what has happened to her, that could worsen a situation.
Right, yes. Yeah.
Mind you, there are some males who are more empathetic than females. Nonetheless, in my opinion, that's not safe for the police, more so than the child at that point.
Yo, trust me, I agree with you, because I've been on juries and the men were more empathetic towards the rape victim than the females on the jury.
I'm not saying that that's across the board. I'm saying personally that male police officers can be very empathetic, while on the flip side, some female officers are suspicious, condescending, et cetera, but that's not across the, it's just life. That's just how some people are. And sometimes the police are dealing with their own issues. Not that it makes it right, but to be real, it is what it is.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Any questions? Comments? Okay. So if anything comes up, just let me know. Just open your mic and speak, because again, I can only see one person at a time. The final social ill that was in the film was the spousal homicide. Now that's the extreme. That's the absolute extreme. When individuals are in relationships and we do all that we can at the center, trying to make females, women aware that if you are in a situation where you are being mistreated, where you are violently assaulted, where you feel less than a human, while leaving may be as risky, staying there could be detrimental. I know, and we know rather, that it's not so easy as that to get out of an abusive relationship, particularly if you don't have a support base, which is why it is so important to not suffer in silence. In our community, we tend to feel, oh, I don't want the neighbors to know what's happening. But if you are unable to go to work for days at a time because you're battered and bruised, if your neighbors can hear you screaming or can hear the arguing, they're knowing anyway. So it's so important to not suffer in silence. It's so important to not die proud, as opposed to living with a little bit of maybe embarrassment, but you'd at least be alive. So we have to, particularly if children are involved, it doesn't lessen the severity of a woman suffering, and it's just her and that man. But if children are involved, that is very far reaching, because you could be teaching your child indirectly to accept abuse or to become an abuser. And so this thing is far reaching when you're talking about families being involved. We need to be very careful what we expose our children to, so that they don't pick up wrong messages and or practice wrongdoing. Well, if mommy didn't have a problem with it, why should I have a problem with it? We don't want our kids to think that. Or if a son sees his dad beating his mom, oh, that's what you're supposed to do. Okay, women, they like to be beaten. You know, that's a sick, twisted thing that we say in our country. I refuse to accept that. Or you have to tap them up for them to know they love you. Or I've actually heard females, high schoolers say, well, if you don't tap me up, he doesn't care. So we have to be very careful the messages we're either speaking into them, or they're picking up, or it's however it's getting through to them to think like that. We need to be very careful, because we're then practicing a successive process that we need to discourage and discontinue. And so it's very important what we allow our children, first of all, to see and hear. And we have to be mindful of what our environment is teaching them. If I'm a mother and I'm cursing for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, how could I expect to beat my child or punish my child for doing the same thing? I'm always saying to the high schoolers when I go into schools, practice makes perfect. Whether it's something positive or negative, practice makes perfect. If you study, and study some more, you're likely to do better than the student who doesn't study. Even if it comes easier for that student, practice makes perfect. If you practice stealing, you're going to get in your mind better and better until you're either caught or killed for trying to steal something that person is not prepared to have you steal. So we have to be very mindful of the things that we expose our children to and the messages we send, whether directly or subliminally. Let's be very, very mindful of that, because in this film, you see where the constant beatings went too far. And as a result, somebody was on death's bed and eventually died. And the young man who was responsible for the date rape, did you notice how he reacted? Now, he felt no kind of way about what he'd just done to the young lady, but he was ready to kill his father for having killed his mother. So even though he has in his head it's okay to do certain things, this is a no-no for his dad to do to his mom. So he still had feelings, but none whatsoever for what he did to the young lady. And so when we have these kinds of things happen, it's like a revolving door. You know, your behavior was caused by something you probably lived through, and you just kind of pass it on. So we need to be very mindful, very, very mindful of the things we do, particularly in the presence of children. They're like sponges, they're just sapping stuff up. So let's be very careful so we don't have a continued proliferation of angry people.
Okay, but what can you do? What could you do when you've got a family member that's being abused and you say to the family member, look, you're being abused, you need to get out of the situation. Let me help you get out of the situation. They say to you, look, this is my life. This is my business. You're just my big brother. Don't get involved in my business. And the family member's killed. That actually happened to me. My 23-year-old sister was involved with a married fella who because she really decided to leave him, he decided that he don't want anybody else to have her, so he killed her. And he killed her in the front of her then 5-year-old daughter. I had to go and pick up the pieces, and then later on, her 5-year-old daughter grew up, had a child for a young man, and the young man beaten on her. So she called me and she said, "Uncle Lamar, this man is beating on me. You need to, could you speak to him for me?" So I called him up and I called him out. I told him, "Look here, don't put your hand on my niece anymore because you'll have to deal with me now." That was back in the day. I wouldn't try that now because, these young fellas, they got guns and all the other stuff. But the abuse stopped and she moved on and she got married. But when I did a look at the family history, her mother was killed and her mother's mother was killed around the same age by a jealous boyfriend too. It seems as if there was a generational curse going on and the case was able to be broken simply because I intervened. I tried to intervene in a mother, but a mother, spurred me and told me my own business. And so there's nothing really I could do. What could we do to intervene with someone who doesn't want to be saved out of an abusive relationship?
In my opinion, it isn't that the individual doesn't want to be saved, I think that there are a number of things that affects, and I'm going to say his or her decision, because men are abused as well. It's not just women. Predominantly females are the ones who are abused, but men are abused as well. And they have, in my opinion, an even tougher time getting assistance because, your girlfriend, your wife is beating you up? Who's the punky? So, that's a whole different situation. But when you have, in my opinion, and from the lessons I've learned from volunteering with the Crisis Center, it's important to just not press, but just keep letting that individual know, I am here, I am willing to help you, let me help you. That individual, regardless of how many people are trying to help him or her, has to make up his or her mind that he or she wants to leave. Forcing, pushing, pressing, it has to come from the individual. And sometimes there are a whole lot of dynamics for the individual who feels as though nothing and no one can help them. Where they're gonna go, how they're gonna live, particularly if the abuser is taking care of the abused. So in my opinion, to just constantly keep, communicate, not constantly, but be in touch, stay in touch, and continually encourage the individual to leave, but also help him or her to explore the possible ways to get out and where to go, because it isn't like someone's going to leave a residence with nowhere to go. That's not realistic. You may say, well, just get out or you won't live to see another day. People have their own rationale, whether to us it makes sense or not, they have their own rationale. Oh, well, at least I have a home and I have food and I have the bills paid. They rationalize that, well, the beating isn't so bad because things are still good. Sometimes just let the individual know constantly, I'm here for you. I'm willing to help you. Let me help you. Now, don't just say let you help and you don't have any ideas yourself, because therein lies a whole other problem. When I say, okay, you say you want to help me. And what do you say? Well, let me see what I could do. You need to have a plan in place. You need to have a plan in place. Now, if you have a home where you can say, you can come and stay with me until you get yourself a job, that's an option. But don't just rush to say, well, come out of the house, because where is he or she going to go? That's still a problem. So the support, letting the individual know that I'm prepared to help you, have a plan. Have a plan. Particularly if this person needs to actually have some place to live. That's a big thing. And if you're not able to take that individual in, where is he or she going to go? That's problem number one, just out the gate. But, you know, badgering them, like, why are you staying in? They don't need that. They only have this issue going on, you know, that's adding insult to injury. You need to be firm, mind you, but not overbearing. Does that answer your question a little bit? Mrs. Smith?
I'm sorry, I didn't get it, Ms. Goodman. What did you say?
No, I was asking you if that answers your question a little bit.
Oh, yes. But I don't know. Sometimes, you know, you may take the person out of the situation, but then the abuser comes behind you and it causes you some problems. So
you need to have a plan.
You probably got to get authorities involved initially.
Yes.
So you establish, you know, that hey, there was abuse going on, and this is the action I'm taking. And this is the person doing the abusing, and you got some level of protection, some level of reporting, you know?
Yes, definitely you should have the authorities. Well, actually, the abused individual needs to make it known that this person is abusing him or her, and you are support-based trying to assist this individual, because you can't report abuse for an adult unless, you know, there's a challenge. But someone who is in all their full capacity need to make a complaint. Yeah.
Okay.
Davis.
Yes.
Ricardo Miller, instructor BTVI. I had situations where in the movie, first of all, it started with the young guy who put the air plugs in his ears, which basically indicates that that's a problem we have in society. Where we tune that out, we don't want to hear the cries.
No. It didn't start there, you know.
It was a part of the beginning where she started, the parent started to abuse the other parent, and he put his right. And so that's basically what we experience in society, where we believe that, boy, I got to tune this out. I hear my neighbor crying, this and that, the next thing. And so a lot of us tune it out because we know the repercussions that can happen. In other words, you could get killed by getting involved. And so some people don't want to get involved. I think Mrs. Smith mentioned that. But my big question, one of the big observations I have is that I had an argument before with someone who stated that, man, some woman think that guys beating them and abusing them is sexy. And I could not believe it. And I argue with that. I argue against it. And a girl told me, yes, man, listen, say some women, they believe that being abused, well, being beaten is a part of that sexual relationship. And so there are some females probably here who believe that, man, he loved me, he doing this because he loved me. And they in that state and don't know the process of getting out of that zone to the point whereas they now seek help, because they believe that, man, boy, listen, when he beat me, he loved me. And that the guy come back and tell everybody, after a while, I really love you, though. And so what would you say to someone in that state now who would like to know, where do I go from here? I can't. I believe he loved me and he beat me, but this thing getting too far. Where do I go from here? What do you say to that person?
First and foremost, let me say I personally do not subscribe to the notion that women feel that men beat them because they love them. Somewhere along the line, something broke and the rationale is off. I just, the thing is, pain, embarrassment, bruising scars, broken bones, and the like, that comes with being physically abused. You have to sometimes, or they have to sometimes seek medical attention. I refuse to accept that women honestly believe that being physically abused is a form of love. Now, why they subscribe to it, something went wrong somewhere, but I refuse to accept that.
I can believe it, but a female actually came in and she confirmed it to me. A female.
Listen to what I'm saying. I refuse to accept
yeah,
that.
Did you? Yeah.
I refuse to accept that something is twisted.
Why we can't get the... Sorry. My mic is open.
We can't. Cox, I'm here. I'm...
Charmaine, your mic is muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Like I was saying, personally, I refuse to accept that females honestly believe that a male physically, well, any type of abuse, just abusing them is a way of showing love. That may be something that happened. And initially they may have felt that they contributed to what happened and therefore he reacted. And so they accept, well, this was just a one-off situation. But at the end of the day, in their heart of hearts, I feel as though they know that what is happening is wrong, but for whatever reason, they are making an excuse for this person's behavior. Notice I'm not saying it's man's behavior because men are abused as well. And so when we look at people who accept it, don't try to get out of it, resist assistance in getting out of it, that's something, again, I cannot relate to. Somewhere in their minds, they may be doing what they think is best, but I can't see someone rationalizing that this severe pain, these bruisings, this mistreatment, the embarrassment that one would feel is all of this stuff is caused by love? I don't know. I can't subscribe to it.
Yeah.
So go ahead.
Sorry, Ms. Davis. I didn't hear everything with Mr. Miller said, right? But I know I have a friend. When we were in school, she said she knew the guy loved her. Because he beat her because he just didn't want her to go anywhere. And he loved her so much because he was jealous. And he just couldn't take her talking to other people. And she really believed that guy loved her. And we was like, no. Because when we were in grade 10, she was dating someone who was out of school. So he was really older. So we were like probably about 15 then. He would have been about in his late 20s. And then we told her, like, no, that he don't love you. He's crazy. But she, I think he engraved in her mind that guess what? If the reason I'm beating you is because I love you so much. I love you that much. And I don't want to lose you. But she believed that, you know, and we talked about it afterwards. And she said, boy, I can't believe how crazy he had me. You know, the guy had me crazy. He almost beat her to death one day, you know, after we graduated. But sometimes because you've been in the situation for so long, you're brainwashed and you actually believe the lies that they're saying to you. Miss Kathy Gray.
Hi.
Just making sure everyone's still here.
Mm-hmm. I need to know what's happening. If she, but like that's why I was saying she probably needs to go in person to somebody, and it'll be Annie.
Sorry, Miss Rose.
She has to. Sorry, I'm on a hotline call. I do apologize.
That's okay.
Yeah, as I was saying. Can you still hear me? Just making sure.
Yes, we can hear you now.
Okay. What I would suggest going forward from this call, I don't know how many of you are on the call, but each one of you now knows about the crisis center, the Bahamas Crisis Center. The number has been made available. Be stewards for the people who are a part of your circle, whether they are their family members, their friends, their colleagues. I'm not saying that you should counsel them. I'm simply saying that you, because you may converse with people who may be having issues and don't know who to turn to, where to go, refer them so that they can get the assistance that they need from the center. Okay? Let me use me as an example. I was about to use somebody else, but I'll use myself as an example. If I call someone a friend, I hurt when she hurts. I mean, I'm thinking specifically of my best friend. If she's hurting, I'm going to hurt. I'm going to want her to get the help she needs. As a matter of fact, I don't know about y'all, but I want to take on the person who's hurting her because I know the good of her. I know the type of person she is, and I know she doesn't deserve it. Not that anybody does. I mean, spanking a child is different, but when we're talking about adults physically brutalizing another one under the guise of love, something is wrong. And it's not with the person who's being abused. It's with the abuser. Let's put the blame where it lies. It's with the abuser. Because if it's that bad, then walk away. Leave. You go. So please keep the number handy. Share it everywhere you go. And you feel as though someone can make use of it. You don't even have to preface sharing the number. You know, we went to this or we won this call and they were talking about some stuff. You know, sometimes you just get depressed or whatever. Just call a number and talk to somebody. It's confidential. We don't ask for your name. And if we do, you have the option of saying you prefer not to say your name, which is fine. If you just want to talk to someone who doesn't know you, the anonymity also helps people when you can just call and just flush your system, relieve some things. You may not necessarily need counseling. You may just need someone who is not going to criticize you. Someone who doesn't know you. You just need to just flush some stuff. And that's what we're supposed to be here for. Bearing in mind, life happens. Someone may not answer right away, but just leave a message or call back. Any other questions or comments?
Hi, Ms. Davis, how are you?
Good, thank you.
I could get the questions are a little bit personal, but how do you handle dealing with so many crises on a daily basis?
Miss Gray, that's you. That's Gray, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now I'm on a hotline call with you. I'm going to share with you, okay? Nobody else is here. Because I work in a police station, I'm exposed to some stuff. And I volunteer with the Bahamas Crisis Center. I'm exposed to some more stuff. It makes me hypersensitive. I won't say to a fault, because when I say hypersensitive, I'm always, if you can see me, I don't know if you can still see me because I can't tell if you can see me. I'm always aware of my surroundings. I'm always alert. When I see an older man with a young child, I watch to see how they are relating to each other because I don't know that this man is someone who this child shouldn't be with. I have a 19-year-old daughter and I'm battling to not cause her to be paranoid because I'm probably this close to being paranoid, but because of the things that happen in my country, I feel I have to be on a level where I'm always careful. Now, Miss Kathy, I'm saying to you, I feel that I'm okay. I think that I'm handling it well because I don't just work, I don't just volunteer. I do have social gatherings, attend social gatherings and the like. But tell me what you think I should do to ensure that I don't be a walking paranoid person. Because I feel I'm okay. But what do you think?
I don't know. I think persons from the crisis center, and I guess persons who deal with this on a daily basis, should get help themselves.
Mm-hmm. Or even options. We do, you know, well, we had stopped for a bit, but I think it's something that we're going to pick up in this new year, where we do have the group for the group.
Right.
Yeah.
Or, is it a point? You can't speak for everybody, but is it right. A point that you become desensitized, like a lot of persons in other areas of society, because they deal with certain things on a daily basis?
I think I've gone to the other side of the spectrum.
You got hyper.
Becoming desensitized. I think
you're over.
Yeah, critically sensitive, okay. Because I'm just. And on my thing is the fact that I have a 19-year-old young lady.
Yes.
I'm really with her. I think I'm borderline paranoid, but I said, I realize there are times that I need to just divorce myself of everything and just do something fun to keep it together.
And see, this is why I feel like the counseling is necessary.
It is. Yeah. And even with that, I can remember I joined the crisis center in, I think it was 94 or 96. And when I first became a part of the group, we had Saturday meetings where we would discuss the business of the center. And for those of us who work hotline, we would have a brief little meeting following the general meeting to share the type of calls that we may have dealt with on our last rotation, mm-hmm. to make sure that we were okay with some of the things that were called in, because we got some, well, let me speak for myself. I've gotten some calls that, give me the shivers, because it made me, and being with the center, it made me more sensitized to what's really happening around me. Because if things are going okay and you everything is good in your world, you tend to think, okay, everything must be okay with everybody, but no. And so it made me more sensitized to the plight of other people. And anytime I get a call where, even though sometimes I'm asked some questions that I cannot provide answers for, I refer. But if I'm able to get someone who has called, for example, crying, I mean crying, that kind of freaks me out, because, well, initially it freaked me out, because what am I supposed to say to someone who's crying? So what I do now is, if someone is crying, and the only thing she can get is, more often than not, females, but I have had male calls, but not crying, but with issues. I just, she's only able to say hello. And when I say good morning or good afternoon, good evening, crisis hotline. And she said, I just don't know. And she just breaks down. I don't say anything. I listen, I let her cry. And when I can hear that she's composing, I'm still here. I'm going to give you a minute, take your time. And at the end of the call, having given her an opportunity to cry, she either tired herself out, or she just needed to flush that stuff. And then she was able to talk. She was able to share why she was crying. Well, she was able to share what she was dealing with. And she said it was just so much. And, you know, this is one of the most impactful calls I'd gotten up to that point, because, you know, she shares some things that any human would I figure crumble under, and she felt as though she was being weak. She was being human. And I said that to you, being human. When I hurt, I cry too. And so we were able to have a conversation where I listened more than I spoke. And if she asked me something, well, what should I do? I let her know it's not for me to tell her what to do. She's in her circumstances. Let's look at the options. What options do you have? Okay, well, maybe I can do this. Maybe I can do that. Which one is easier to implement? Well, maybe this one for now. And she was able to determine what her course of action should be based on her experience in her situation. So we don't come on the line, or we're not supposed to come on the line and say, well, you should do this and you should do that, unless we're referring you to somebody. But I think maybe you need to see this person as opposed to us because of what you're dealing with. But Sometimes, not all the time. Sometimes people know what they need to do, what they want to be told what to do. But I can't tell you if to go left or right, depending on where you're trying to get. You all understand? Miss Kathy, you understand?
Yes, ma'am. I do. I understand exactly what you're saying. But I do suggest that you all get the help. I mean, you know, start back this year, that you all get help, because it could be a lot. Just hearing about it and watching that video, I'm not in the trenches with you guys every day, and I realize that it's a lot that you all deal with, and you all need help as well.
Mrs. Davis.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you now, yes.
Okay, good.
You said something that kind of made me kind of distressed. Because you say if you see an older man with a younger girl that you kind of look at him suspiciously.
Question. Did I say suspiciously? I did say that? I'm just checking.
Maybe I understood wrong. Questionably.
Okay. Well, yeah, that's probably what I meant.
I have three granddaughters. Mm-hmm. One is 5, the other one is 12, the other one is 13.
Okay.
And when they see me, they become ecstatic. They run up to me and, "Hi, Grumpy. We love you. We've seen for a long time." And, mm-hmm. and they give me this affection. Are you telling me that if you were to see something like that, you look at me with a jaundiced eye and wonder why they're responding to him like that?
Now, let me say this to you. And
I find that disconcerting.
You know, let me say this to you.
Okay.
I take or I react depending on the environment I'm in. If I'm out to dinner and I see a relatively settled, I won't say old, I won't say young, a relatively settled man coming with someone who may just barely be 19. It could be his daughter, hey. The body mm-hmm. language tells a lot about situations if you know how to read it.
Okay.
The interaction with the individual can tell you a lot if you know how to read it.
Okay.
There's a certain way a dad would relate to his daughter, his grandchildren, his nieces, his nephews, versus someone who at the end of this date is expecting something.
Okay.
Let's be real. It is what it is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about watching people being loving to relatives. It's a difference. There's a difference. There's a body
Yes, definitely. I take your point.
Okay. Thank you, Mrs. Smith.
No problem.
Any other questions or comments? Anything else about any questions or comments? Anything you want to share as it relates to the video? Everyone is okay with what they saw? When I say okay, you understood everything and you don't have any questions or anything about the video? Just making sure we covered the video. No one is leaving wondering of something that was in the video that may have sparked something else. We're all good with the video?
That video was kind of distressing, and I trust.
I'm sure.
I trust that was all play acting.
It was, but then it addressed real issues. Very real
issues.
Yeah,
and seemed so real. Yes.
They did a very good job with that.
Yes. I commend them on that.
Mm-hmm. I will share just one final, I guess, sharing. I'll just share something with you. I showed them the same video was shared with, I think it was 7th and 9th graders. And it was in a church hall some years ago. And when I walked, they initially said it was going to be just girls. And when I walked in, they said it was going to be just 2 classes. And it ended up being all of the 7th through 9th graders from one of our junior high schools. And as I walked in, they had, well, of course, they had the conversations going on. And So, you know, I was introduced. I went and I said my greetings and I said, okay, I have a video that I want to play for you all. Of course, you know, entertaining young people is not easy. Keeping their attention is not easy. When we put the video on, there was no sound. They tried everything. There was no sound. So now I'm like, what do I do? The video was rolling. It was playing, but there was no sound. And I said to them, okay, obviously we're going to need to reschedule this date to have this thing, you know, fixed, have the problem fixed and come back. Those students were like, no, we understand what's going on. We understand. And we know what's going on. There was this one little girl in particular who was like, okay, and so this one here, oh yeah, he mad because, so she was basically the sound of the video, eh? And I was like, well, you need to hear what they're saying. Like, oh yeah, I know that, yeah, that's great. But, and you know, they were, listen, these young people were fixed on this video, no sound, but they were watching what was happening and understanding, for the most part, I guess, what was happening. About a third through the video, sound came on and they applauded. They applauded because, okay, now they were, you could hear, you're here growing in that room with, I don't know how many children there were, but there were 7th through 9th graders and they were silent and fixed on this video. So why do I say that? I say that to share with you, even though there was no sound, they understood the dynamics in the movie. Now the sound enhanced what was happening. And so it was demanded that we start it over so they could hear and watch it. And I, not at any time, no time at all, did I ever say, could you please be quiet? They were fixed on this thing. And afterwards, the conversation was so flowing, we almost had to make them want to leave, which I thought was really good because there's a lesson in this video, where there are lessons really, but the overriding lesson, in my opinion, is let's not be passive about abuse. Let's not abuse each other. Let's listen to our children. Let's know who our children are with, what they are doing, where they are going. Let's be mindful of how we relate to one another. It's okay to be on different ends of a fence. Let's agree to disagree. But this violence, and all of us right now are aware of the things happening in our country every night. Someone is shot. You may not hear about that every night, people being shot because they've not died. You all may hear about the deaths. Every night, gunshots go off somewhere. All day, the police is trying to catch criminals. Now, I'm not gonna try and sell the police as perfect people because they are not. They are people like me and you who come from communities around the country who work, who want to go home to their families at the end of their shift. They're not superhumans. Don't expect the unexpected. Yes, some of them can do better. I fully agree. However, there are police officers who are doing their best with what they have to work with. And when I say with what they have to work with, you may see a lot of police cars. There are not enough cars to have bodies in them to patrol or be present everywhere. But the police force is doing its best. Our commissioner has committed to trying to make our communities as safe for those of us who live here and those of us who visit here. And so in any way you can assist your police, I know people don't like to call in tips. Every one of us knows a police officer who is a friend or a relative. Just slide the information to him or her, someone you trust, and say, well, you know, you may need to look at this house down the road, number whatever on it. Something is off at that house. Something is not right in that house. No one needs to be to be the wiser that you made that information available. The police could go there and find illegal drugs, illegal firearms, a child who's been raped in there, a child who's being held in there, because these things are happening in our country. Children are being held against their will. Children are, for whatever reason now, they seem to be wanting to snatch up children, just randomly snatch up children. What's going on in our country? We can't afford to say, well, it doesn't affect me. And so it does affect you, because who's to say that someone in your family, one of your loved ones, isn't touched by this stuff that's happening? So we need to be on the same page, trying to eradicate crime, at this point, lessen it a whole lot because there's a whole lot going on in the country and we need to be our brother's keeper. If there are no additional questions, I am now done. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Mrs. Davis.
One last thing.
Someone else have a question? Go ahead.
Yeah, is it possible for that video to be shared or it's just for you guys?
At this point, I do not know that we are distributing it.
Okay.
But you can speak with Ms. Rule to confirm or deny that. But I have not known it to be shared with anybody.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Ms. Rule, do you distribute the video or do you have to attend like a session with the crisis center? Okay, Ms. Gray, I'll check with you. I'll check for you. After the session, I'll check. I'll speak to Ms. Rowell. But I want to thank the team from the Crisis Center. You're welcome. Mrs. Davis and Mrs. Rowell for I want to thank the team from the Crisis Center, Mrs. Rowell and especially Mrs. Davis for a very informative session. My prayers is that what is learned here today on the short film that we would have seen, that we can take that information to, if it hasn't helped someone on the session, but to help someone else that we know to be our brother's keeper. And again, thank you for taking the time out, everybody else who's on the session today. May God bless you all. Have a great day.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Have a good day, everyone.